Hello and welcome to Bryer's Sea Showcase. I am, of course, Bryer Cisneros, and as you can see, I am in a different location this time. Before, I would film in my living room, but today, I'm actually going to be filming inside my bedroom. And so that way, you can actually see the collection behind me. There's starts back there, and then it kind of goes in that area, and there's more over there as well. There's a poster right there, there's a Jesus Priest poster right there. There's a UFO one also over there. And you can kind of see, but there's a Steve Perry one as well that's from his latest album. But hopefully you enjoy the background here. It should fit the theme of this channel a little bit better. So moving on from that, today in this video, I am going to be doing another ranking. It's been a while. Last one I did was with Genesis, but today I'm going to be doing a different band. And today the band I chose was this band right here. If you can't see, it is of course Creedence Clearwater Revival. One of the most popular bands of the late 1960s to early 70s. They only released 7 albums and they were only together for, I believe, 5 years, which is just incredible. Of course, you have John Fogerty on lead vocals and lead guitar. You have Tom Fogerty on rhythm guitar, Stu Cook on bass, and Doug Clifford on drums. And for that period of time, those 4 members would create some of the most recognizable, most enduring hits of all time, and in this video I am going to be paying tribute to them. So I have the CDs over there, that's kind of why I'm looking to the side there. So again, there's only 7, so without further ado, let's get this ranking going. And before I actually do though, before I forget, please remember that this is all my opinion. You could rank these differently than what I have, that's totally okay. Just make sure you comment below your thoughts and how you would rank them in the comments below. So let's get started now. Coming in at number 7, to no surprise to anybody, I have, of course, Mardi Gras, released in 1972. If you know the history of this album, then you kind of already know that at this point the band was basically imploding in itself. Tom Fogerty left the band and it was just John, Stu, and Doug. And this other one's also significant, and that is because this is the first album where John doesn't write or sing all the songs. Here you have Stu and Doug contributing, writing songs and singing on them as well. So this album starts with Looking for a Reason, which in my opinion is one of the worst opening songs ever, because it has a very depressing feel to it, and that depressing feeling kind of carries out throughout the whole album. You can obviously tell this band is falling apart. The songs sung by Stu Cook, they're just laughably bad. Maybe you move over, get someone else to change, try their luck. Doug Clifford's voice, his voice is okay, just nothing to write home about. And John's songs, for the most part, they're pretty good, but you can tell he's not giving it his all. He's just done at this point. But yeah, this album is just not very good as a whole. And I can see people defending this album and saying, oh, it's not that bad. But you gotta remember, this is Creedence Clearwater Revival. I mean, everything else before was just top shelf. And then you have this where it's just meh. Overall, it's kind of a shame they had to go out like this because it's really not good. If you happen to own a copy, then this is definitely one where you can just go ahead and just toss in the trash and just never listen to again. But if you're me, who is a completionist, then you can go ahead and take it out of the trash and just put it back. And that is Mardi Gras at number 7. Alright, now that we got Mardi Gras out of the way, now I can happily say that all the albums moving forward are all good. There is no bad albums here on out. And really, if I'm really honest with myself, these could change at any point. So this is how I rank them currently. So at number 6, I'm going to go with their self-titled debut. Now this might be a shock to some of you. Some of you might put this a bit higher, and I can totally see why. For a first album, this is definitely very strong. There's a lot of covers on it. It's very bluesy, which is okay. But to me, I think they would totally make much better music moving forward. But for your first album, it's still, again, a very strong start. Starts off with a cover, I Put a Spell on You, the Screaming Jay Hawkins song, which is really good. They do a really good job on it. Then they have Working Man, which is great. Susie Q, one of my favorite songs on here. There's only 8 songs on this album, and they're all very strong. Again, I prefer other albums than this, but still, it's still a very strong first album. At number 5, we have Pendulum, released in 1970. Some people might be surprised for me ranking it higher than the debut, but this album kinda surprised me, because I have only recently heard this album in full, and I was, again, pretty shocked by it. I really enjoy this. This one features a bit more keyboards than usual. I think in Cosmos Factory they put a little bit of keyboards, but here you can definitely, they have a bit more of a prominent use in this, which is fine. I think it works really well. I think the keyboards really fit on a lot of the songs on this, and it's a very good album. I think it's just as good as their most classic albums. I don't think this one gets as much love as the others. And again, I can see why. This is kind of when the cracks were starting to show, but I still think they're able to hold together long enough to still make some great music here. And the songs on here is really good. I will say the problem I don't like about this particular issue is that all the songs are out of order than what it is on the actual disc. But that's okay. But Chameleon's great. Sailor's Lament is really catchy. That's kind of where the keyboards are really prominent, which again I don't mind. I really like it. And of course it has the big hit Have You Ever Seen the Rain, which is one of my favorite Creedence Clearwater Revival songs. It's Just a Thought, and many other songs on here I think are very good. I would say this is definitely one of their most underrated albums. So my number 4 and my number 3 could change because I think I like them equally. So again, this is what I have them as of late. So I'm gonna go with Green River next. This was their third album, I believe. And what a good album this is. Just, it has some classic songs on here. Of course, Green River, and of course, Bad Moon Rising, another very popular song by them. But again, all the other songs are still very good. You got Commotion, which is great. Wrote a Song for Everyone, Lodi, Sinister Purpose, The Nighttime is the Right Time. This was during that classic run of just classic albums. I think this was released in 1969. This was the second album released in that year, which is, again, just incredible just how busy they were and how well they were able to crank out just gem after gem. That could have led to their downfall because of, you know, it's overworking and leading to burnout. But this was definitely during their peak period here, and it definitely deserves to be recognized. I just want to quickly point out though, that album cover I'm not a huge fan of because it's so overexposed. I don't know why they went with this, and the back cover is not that better in my opinion, but I guess it has its charm. I guess that people seem to like it. It's pretty iconic in a sense. But yeah, I just want to add a little note in. But again, Green River, great one. Okay, so now we're entering the top 3. Entering third place, I'm going to go with Bayou Country, released in 1969, is their second album. And definitely a huge improvement of the first album, in my opinion. This is definitely where John Fogerty is really coming in his own as a songwriter, and even as a vocalist, I would say. Starts out with Born on the Bayou, which is just a great, great, great rocker. Very bluesy, has a bit of a southern flair to it, even though they're from California, ironically, but that's besides the point. Then goes to Bootleg and Graveyard Train, and they have a great cover of Good Golly Miss Molly on here. Just really good. Just John just really kills it on it. Of course, it has one of the most famous songs, Proud Mary, which it's been covered many times, most famously Tina Turner. And then it ends off with Keep On Shoogling, which is a great closer. Again, this is a huge step up from the first album. Top to Bomb is a drop-dead classic, and if you're a Creedence fan, I don't know why you wouldn't have this in your collection. So, Bayou Country, give it a listen. Right in second place, I'm gonna go with Willie and the Poor Boys. Again, released in 1969. Man, just what a great album this is. Just, this is probably the most, I would say this is the most coherent album as a whole. Not to saying that some of the other ones I've mentioned aren't coherent, but this is definitely feels like there's a running theme here. I believe there are some misconceptions on this album saying that it's a concept album. I mean, I can kind of see it, because it's about Willie and the Poor Boys, which is a skiffle band, and the first song starts with Down on the Corner, which definitely has that sound to it, and they even name the album in the song. I don't think it's a concept album, but I can see why people might think it. Many people would cite this as their number one favorite, and again, I can see, because there are so many classic songs in here. Down on the Corner, I just mentioned. It Came Out of the Sky, Cotton Fields is great. Feeling Blue, another great bluesy song. And of course, has probably the most famous song of all time, which is Fortunate Son, which has been used in many soundtracks. Like anything involving the Vietnam War, you'll hear it. The Midnight Special, Effigy. Like, it's a classic for a reason. There are many reasons why many people would put this at number one. It's number two for me because there's one album that I kind of prefer a little bit more, but again, a little bit, because there's really not much difference here. So, Willie and the Poor Boys at number two. And finally, at number one, I'm gonna go with Cosmos Factory, released in 1970. To many people, this is the last of that classic period where every album before was really nothing but net. And you can kind of see why, because I can probably imagine that they put all their energy into this one, because they definitely were experimenting a little bit more than usual on this, because it starts off with Ramble Tamble, which is a 7-minute song, and it just rocks. It's an incredible opening track. Don't You Accuse Me is great, Traveling Band, Looking Out My Back Door, Run Through the Jungle, which is another classic song, Up Around the Bend, Who Will Stop the Rain, another one of my favorite songs by them, and it finishes off with their incredible cover, their 11-minute cover of I Heard It Through the Grapevine, which is just incredible. It definitely needs to be heard, the full version, I mean, because I know there's a version on YouTube where it's a shortened version, like a singles version, I'm assuming, but the 11-minute version is definitely something you gotta check out if you haven't yet. I do think this is the last album where everyone was working as a band, just before all the bickering really started to take hold, and if that's the case, then they really ended that classic period on a high note. So, Cosmos Factory, absolutely worth a listen. And there you have it, that is my ranking of every CCR album. And just real quick, let me just give a brief recap. So again, at number one, we have Cosmos Factory. Number two, Willie and the Poor Boys. Number three, Bayou Country. Number four, Green River. Number five, Pendulum. Number six, the self-titled. And at number seven, we have Mardi Gras. Like I said in the beginning of the video, make sure you comment below how you would rank these albums. And of course, make sure you leave a like and subscribe for more videos like this. I really do appreciate it if you would. And that's about it. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video. Take care, and goodbye for now.